It is time for the Writer's Block, our weekly look at all things sports. I'm Jenny Carlson here in the newsroom of the Oklahoman, joined by Cedric Golden in the newsroom of the Austin American-Statesman. Ced, how's it going?
Man, it's going great. How are you, Jen?
I'm good. Spring is here. Lots going on. And top of the list in our lead segment this week is the Final Four. The NCAA tournaments are over, but a couple of fantastic Final Fours, both men and women. Cedric, lots of storylines to talk about, but, you know, around here, people were obviously very aware of Texas Tech and the run they made all the way to the championship game. People thought the world might end with those two defensive teams going at it, but we got treated to a fantastic final.
We really did, and I was really hoping that Texas Tech would win. Now, full disclosure, I picked Virginia at the beginning of the tournament to win it, so I'll pop my collar on that one, but Texas Tech was a better story after losing to Baltimore, Maryland, Baltimore County, whatever they were, the team with the nun. They lost to them, and they were a punching bag and a punchline all season long. They come back and win it under Tony Bennett. That was a great story, but I wish that Texas Tech with Chris Beer, that was cool. It was really cool for them to win. It would have been cool for them to win. With the story, with the grad transfers, with Jared Culver, a hometown kid, staying in Lubbock when he could have gone anywhere else, and a coach who had served 10 years under Bob Knight. Oh, my God. I think that's enough right there to make anybody want to pull for this guy if you work for Bob Knight for 10 years. So Elite Eight last year, finals this year, yeah. Maybe next year they break through, but I know this might not be popular in Lubbock, Jenny, but guess what, Tech? You're a basketball school now. You're no longer a football school. That replaced Graham Harrell to Michael Crabtree to knock Texas out of the title chase in 08. You're a basketball school now. Now, the next order of business, Kirby Holcutt, AD, pull that bridge truck up to Chris Beard's house.
Yeah.
Throw several truckloads of money at him to keep him in Lubbock for the rest of his career.
Yeah, and Chris Beard obviously has the formula figured out. He lost so many guys off of last year's team. Nobody expects Tech to even contend for the Big 12, much less contend for a national championship. An unbelievable job by Chris Beard and his entire staff, that entire team, to make the final and so, so close to winning a championship. But Cedric, as you said, hard not to feel good for Virginia after losing to the 16, first one seed to lose to a 16 a year ago, now a year later to win the national championship. Unbelievable story. But you know what? Also unbelievable, the Baylor women. Cedric, the state of Texas had a chance to sweep the men's NIT championship, the women's NCAA, and the men's NCAA. Didn't quite happen, but Baylor, Cedric, you and I saw it with our own eyes. Those gals were dominant all year, and it continued throughout the NCAA tournament. And then what a game in the finals against Notre Dame.
You have to give Kim Mulkey credit. And your very own Barry Trammell nicknamed her Cruella DeVille, which is the best nickname ever. Cruella brought the noise, and she took care of business. Her big girl, Kalani Brown, was as good as advertised. They survived the loss of Lauren Cox, their other twin tower, to a knee injury. And those guards, Chloe Jackson, Dee Dee Richards, they were as good as they've been all season long. The mark of a great team is not only to bring it in the regular season, but to bring it in the postseason. Kim Mulkey has three national championships now. Yep. She is a future Hall of Famer, first ballot. You can't deny it. She also won a national championship as a point guard in 1982 for La Tech. So you're talking about a historic career, a legendary career. Yeah. Kudos to the Baylor women. She wants them to go to the White House to visit with President Trump. Don't know about all of that, Jay Carr, but if she's down, good for them. I congratulate the Baylor women. As someone that lives in Austin, where women's basketball is very popular, the bar has been raised. Kim Mulkey is arguably, she's right there with Ariema. The other one's Muffet McGraw.
Sure.
She's in the short conversation, Vic Schaefer, with the best women's coaches on the planet.
You know, Cedric, I was super impressed, obviously, by Baylor's entire body of work this season. But, you know, it was interesting to me to watch how Baylor dominated the first four games they played in the NCAA tournament. I mean, just ran away from people. And it wasn't even close at the end of those games. Then for them to go into the Final Four and have close calls, obviously great teams in the Final Four. You had Oregon that they beat in the semis. Then you had Notre Dame, which had upended UConn in the other semifinal, in the final. So fantastic opponents. They had to really grind. And then, Cedric, you mentioned it, Lauren Cox going down with an injury, out of the game, mentally devastating, then obviously devastating to what the Bears did on the floor. For them to be able to sustain and continue and then win that ball game, unbelievable intestinal fortitude by Baylor, a well-deserved championship. Apparently, by the way, those championships you referenced, the third for Kim Mulkey, every 7 years. I bet she wants to do it a little bit sooner next time, Cedric, but still, three championships, you can't argue with that. Great for Baylor and a championship for the Big 12. Those are never, ever a bad thing. By the way, if you don't like basketball talk, you might want to look elsewhere because we're going to keep talking basketball. Our second segment this week is our Say What segment. And Cedric, say what? Magic Johnson steps up and just resigns from the Lakers? This was out of left field. I'll mix my sports metaphors, but nobody saw this coming, Cedric.
No one saw it coming, and it was so weird. And Magic came across as sort of a weasel in all of this, Jen, because he didn't tell Jenny Buss that he was leaving. He kept going, well, you know, my sister this and my sister that. Man, if I was quitting my job and I work for my sister, I think I would call her and tell her.
Yeah.
He hastily arranges his presser 50 minutes before a game, and he's in there and he's surrounded by media, and he is just letting it all hang out, making little insinuations, talking about backstabbing and not really portraying Luke Walton or GM Rob Pelinka in a positive light. I thought it came across as, I'm taking my ball and I'm going home. I'm a billionaire and I don't want to work anymore. I thought it was one of the most unprofessional things I've ever seen. I love Magic Johnson. We know his story and what he's overcome in his life. But professionally speaking, I thought that was horse crap. I didn't like it at all.
Well, and you know, the whole thing he said, I want to have fun again. Well, okay. But yeah, no, Cedric, I think you're right.
What are you, seven?
I mean,
I want to have fun again? I mean, come on.
Yeah.
You want to have fun again?
You know what? If he wants to have fun as a fan, go for it. But to me, at this point, I don't know how Magic Johnson ever gets another basketball front office job. I mean, and maybe he doesn't want one. Maybe that's the end game here. You know, he worked for the team that he played for. Maybe that was a dream spot. He found out it wasn't what he thought it would be. It wasn't nearly, you know, the joy ride that he expected. I don't know. They win the LeBron sweepstakes. Everybody thinks they're heading on the up and up. Then things fall apart with Kawhi Leonard. They don't get him in the offseason. Then they go after Anthony Davis, and that becomes the train wreck that, you know, not only messes with the Pelicans, but messes with the Lakers. They fall apart. Now what's next becomes a huge question mark as LeBron ages, and it looks like he needs a serious superstar sidekick in LA. And so, you know, yeah, I don't know. The hard work was coming, Cedric. I mean, to this point, as bad as the Lakers were, you know, if Magic Johnson thought this was tough, he was about ready to face some really tough questions. You know, does this mean that maybe superstar players might think twice about going to play for the Lakers just because of the mess that all this has become? I don't know. To me, that's the next big question for the Lakers after all of this with Magic Johnson. What does this do for the Lakers and their attempts to try to lure another great player?
That's a really good question, Jen. And I'm telling you, you talked about potential Magic getting another job as an administrator, as a personnel guy. There's a better chance of him getting another talk show than getting another NBA job. Thank God Magic Johnson's got $600 million in the bank. He doesn't need it, but don't go in there thinking that all you got to do is go in and flash that megawatt smile and things are going to fall into place. He didn't work really hard in personnel decision. He wasn't at the Final Four, reportedly, and we know there's some talent in that tournament. And so I just thought it came across as really weaselly and surprising for Magic Johnson. There are guys in this league that work hard to get the great talent. They've got salary cap space. The city sells itself. Anthony Davis or Kawhi Leonard or KD, one of those guys is probably going to end up with the Lakers, and I think it's probably going to be Anthony Davis. And you put a couple of pieces around him and LeBron, and you're going to compete in the West. But I thought Magic Johnson, I just don't think that was one of his finest hours. That was really strange.
Yeah, definitely so. Lots of questions, and you know, a question obviously that is already answered. Lakers not making the playoffs. We've known that for weeks. Now the Western Conference, which will be really difficult, gets ready to heat up. We'll be watching that around here, obviously, with the Thunder in Oklahoma City, the Spurs down around you, Cedric. But I'm interested to see what happens in the East as well. You know, we've seen these teams. The West is still the tough side of the bracket, if you will. But the East, we've seen a lot of these teams really kind of bow up and look like they want to play for a title right now. Milwaukee, Toronto, Boston, teams like that you wonder, maybe first round matchups are you know, maybe four or five games. You're looking at sweeps maybe in a couple. But I think we're going to see some really good series in the East, maybe earlier than we have in recent years. But it still feels like to me, Cedric, when we're talking about NBA playoffs, it's still the Warriors' title to lose at this point. I still think with all the pieces they have the widest margin for error. And then the playoffs, that's a pretty big deal. I still like the Warriors to win it all.
I do too. Steph Curry hurt his ankle, and he's probably going to be limited in the first round. They'll probably be really careful with him. They get the Los Angeles Clippers. They shouldn't have any problem with the Clippers. They should take them out in four or five. And so after that, it gets a little scary if you're looking at a Houston or somebody like that. But I still think it's Golden State's ball to take and win. It's a dysfunctional locker room. I don't think Kevin Durant and Draymond Green are going to be hanging out on Christmas Day together. I think those guys hate each other. But over in the East, the Greek Freak has Milwaukee as a top seed. The Boston Celtics are still very talented, even though they've had some struggles. And Kawhi Leonard is a finals MVP. He's back healthy in the playoffs. Watch out for the Toronto Raptors. I don't expect them to have any problems with the Orlando Magic in the first round. I think it's going to be Milwaukee and Toronto in the Eastern Conference. Though one of those teams is going to come out of the East.
Yeah, I like both of those teams as well. And it's exciting to see some teams that maybe haven't, you know, been in the mix for a while be there, especially if the West offers up Golden State again, which, you know, there are some great, great teams in the West. There's no doubt about it. But it's hard to see how, when you've got the wealth of shooting talent that the Warriors have, it's hard to see how they don't find a way to get it, even with all of the pitfalls that the West presents. It's hard to see how they don't figure out a way to get through there. All right, I promise basketball. We keep going with basketball in segment three, living their best life, Cedric. And it looks like Zion Williamson, the presumed number one overall draft pick in the NBA draft, hasn't announced he's leaving, but assumed he will. Sounds like he was living a pretty good life even before. Some reports coming out that maybe the Williamson family got some extra dollars while Zion was at Duke, huh?
Yeah, hearing that maybe Nike hired his mom as a consultant, gave her $150,000. Boy, I would love to be a consultant for Nike. If that's what consulting is paying, I need to hire a consultant to figure out how to get a consultant's job in Oregon. You know what? I saw this story, and they were saying it was, you know, the ugly word bribery was thrown around. And I live in Austin, so and that word's been thrown around a lot lately with the UT tennis program.
Right.
I digress. He pleaded guilty, by the way. But if they gave her $150,000 to deliver Zion, I wish she could have gotten $300,000. Because Zion Williamson doesn't get any money to play basketball.
Right.
Zion Williamson, arguably the most popular basketball player in America this past season, because LeBron James, as good as he was, the Lakers weren't really relevant this year. So I'm not mad at Zion. I'm not mad at his mom. If they got a bag of money, just a mere pittance of what the NCAA is making off these kids, I'm not mad at all. Money is money. He's not going to get any money for his likeness. He's not going to get any money for playing basketball. He's going to get a ton of money when he signs his endorsement contract and his NBA contract. But as far as we're talking about, as far as an amateur athlete getting a piece of the pie, more power to him.
Yeah, you know, and we've talked about this before, Cedric, but the whole cloud over college basketball since, you know, it's been 2 years or so since the FBI announced that they had looked into some things involving college basketball, indictments, assistant coaches, fixers, middlemen involved in all that. So ever since then, there's been wiretaps and all measure of scandal out there. But, you know, the thing that I'm with you, I know people say, hey, wait, athletes get free education, room and board, all of that. But it's hard to square in your mind how much money Coach K is making, for example, at Duke, with what Zion Williamson and any other player at Duke is receiving as a, you know, full-time athlete in addition to being a full-time student at Duke. So, you know, for the NCAA, I think they're going to have to continue. I know nobody at the NCAA wants to think about how much they need or how much they would have to pay if players were somehow compensated, especially in men's basketball, in football, those sorts of things. But these are the types of things that the NCAA is going to have to continue to face if they don't figure out some way to do something for the players that goes beyond just the basics, because you've got athletes coming from situations where it's not enough. If mom can't pay the light bill or dad can't, you know, make the car payment, they feel like they need to help as much as they can, and so these things are happening, and I don't think that that's going to change, unfortunately. So does that force the NCAA's hand? I think that becomes a real question that, Cedric, you would hope leaders in the NCAA are at least talking about, maybe not publicly, but doesn't there have to be some conversation happening among NCAA leaders about this?
Oh, absolutely. And guess who's getting rich, Jen? Coaches, athletic directors, TV executives, conferences, Big 12, yeah. SEC, you name it. You got Roy Williams doing car commercials with that Ram. And I guess it's Chrysler, and I guess the Dodge Ram. I understand the marketing behind that. Coach K's got radio shows, and everybody's getting rich, and the players are holding the bag. Yeah. I'm sorry, congratulations. Here's your degree and a $40,000 a year job. Your coach, John Calipari's making $9.2 million a year.
Yeah.
And I can't remember the last time Calipari made a layup or a free throw or stopped anybody on defense.
Yeah,
I know college is supposed – the biggest joke going is that college is amateur athletics. The only amateur part about it are the people playing it. Everybody else is getting money. People like you and me getting charged $100 just to see a college football game, wearing shirts with V. Young on the back of it, yeah, and Colt McCoy and Sam Bradford. Their jerseys are selling like hotcakes. You think the Baker Mayfield jersey, they can't even keep those in stock now in Norman. So those kind of things, Kyler Murray, those kind of things are just adding to the pot that is the solid gold printing press, printing money machine that is college football and college basketball, and the kids aren't getting any of that money. Great to get a scholarship, but when you represent your team, there's one thing, but when you're making all these dollars for your school, you should share in some of those profits. I will go to my grave believing that.
Well, while we're talking about the Williamsons possibly living a good life, here's somebody else living a good life this week, Cedric. That's a couple NBA greats that are getting ready to retire, Dirk Nowitzki and Dwayne Wade, both announcing, Dirk making it official earlier this week. He is done playing in the NBA. We knew Dwayne Wade was finishing up his career, but special moments for both of those guys. Cedric, if you didn't see it yet, go watch that commercial that Budweiser has produced.
I've seen it.
I may or may not be a Budweiser fan, but that commercial was fantastic. And then obviously all the people that showed up for the retirement ceremonies for those guys, unbelievable stuff. And Cedric, both of those guys have been nothing but class during their time in the league. Champions, both of them, both have at least one NBA championship ring. Unbelievable careers, unbelievable legacies that both of those guys have left.
Represented the league with class, dignity, and just and they were fun to watch.
Absolutely.
Vinsky changed how 6'11 guys are viewed in this league. He came into this league shooting jumpers and threes, and people were like, you better get your big butt down on the block and go dunk on somebody. But then they noticed that he'd made four threes.
Yep.
And all of a sudden people are like, he's a stretch four. That's what we'll call it. He's a stretch four. He's a big guy that can shoot threes. And so he changed the way the position is played. Dwayne Wade and Allen Iverson changed the way point guard is played. Those guys did not mind scoring. They might only have three or four assists, but you look up and they're running. The offensive are running through them. And when you look at how they impacted the game, they not only impacted it on the floor, they're both very much involved in charitable pursuits. You saw the commercial with D-Wade. He helped so many kids. That made my heart full, because what we like to do, and even in our business, is we try to use our jobs as a platform to make our communities better. And when you're impacting communities outside of what you do for a living, that is the impact. We're going to always remember that these guys were great at basketball. But if you can help a few people along the way in your journey, then you stand even taller. And I love that about these two. We need more like them. And as a basketball fan, I want to applaud them for what they did on the court and off the court.
Yep. I couldn't have said it any better myself, so I won't even try. Cedric, great stuff. Another week of the writer's block has come and gone. That's it for this week. Come back, though, and see us next week. We'll see you then.